Hi, good evening, folks. Welcome. My name is Sophia Lems. I'm the Curator of Public Programs and Research at Nottingham Contemporary, a contemporary arts center in the UK. And tonight it is my pleasure welcoming you to Five Bodies, our online poetry program. For those of you tuning in for the first time, Nottingham Contemporary invites artists and academics to reflect on how research and practice intertwine in contemporary art and visual cultures. Our public programs aim to understand how sensing, feeling, and knowing might support different world-making perspectives. This is our fourth session of the year-long poetry series, which looks at how critical creative practices of attention, of invention, of experimentation might help us develop new sensibilities. The program welcomes some unexpected pairings and drifts, but most importantly, it welcomes multiple voices to reflect on how poetics is not the recognized or the given modalities of form, but the reconciliation of feeling and knowing in creative practice. Five Bodies was imagined in conjunction with our colleague Sarah Jackson at Nottingham Trent University, who has led the critical poetics research group since 2015 and is interested in pursuing hybrid methodologies and experimental thinking. Before we begin, I'd like to take this opportunity to show our gratitude to tonight's poets, artists, healers, and pedagogues, Himali Singh Soin, joining us from Delhi, Ariana Rains and Simone White, joining us from New York, and who have kindly accepted to contribute incredible readings for our session this evening. I'd also like to thank Sarah Jackson, Olivia Ahern, and Jack Thacker for their invaluable work developing the series, as well as the sibling workshops. And of course, a word of thank you to Nottingham Trent University and to the University of Nottingham for graciously and generously supporting our events, as well as the opportunity to acknowledge my colleagues Ryan Kearney, James Brower, and Catherine Masters, who are supporting us this evening. Tonight's event includes three 20-minute readings, followed by a 5-minute tea break and a joint conversation with our guests. You're warmly welcome to write your questions, your comments, to share your thoughts and references on the YouTube chat box, which I'll happily weave into the conversation. We also have an AI-driven live captioning system which can be found in the YouTube chat. This will open a separate window on your browser, and within that you can adjust the scale and layout to suit your requirements. So without further ado, I'm delighted to introduce tonight's contributors. Himali Singh Soin is a writer and an artist based between London and Delhi. She uses metaphors from outer space and the natural environment to construct imaginary and cosmologies of interferences, entanglements, deep voids, debris, delays, alienation, distance, and intimacy. In doing this, she thinks through ecological loss and the loss of home, seeking shelter somewhere in the radicality of love. Her speculations are performed in audiovisual and immersive environments. Ariana Reyes is a poet, Obie-winning playwright, and performing artist. Her books include The Cow, Cœur de Lion, Mercury, and more recently, A Sand Book from 2020, winner of the Kingsley Tufts Prize, and longlisted for the 2019 National Book Award. She has created performances for numerous museums and art institutions. She has taught at Yale, NYU, Columbia, UC Berkeley, and many others. In 2012, she created Lazy Eye Weaver, an astrology practice focused on new forms of art and consciousness pedagogy. In March 2020, she founded Invisible College, a digital experiment in poetry, performance, and community. Finally, Simone White is a poet and critic. She's the author of Dear Angel of Death, of Being Dispersed, and House of Envy in All of the World, as well as the chapbooks Unrest and Dolly. Her newest book, Or On Being the Other Woman, is forthcoming in 2021 with Duke University Press. Her work has also appeared in publications including Art Forum, BOMB, eFlex Journal, The Chicago Review, The New York Times Book Review, and she teaches in the English Department of the University of Pennsylvania and on the faculty of Milton Avery Graduate School of Arts at Bard College. So thank you all for listening, and I'll turn over to Himalina.
Thank you, Sophia, for having us, and I'm so honored to be in this company. I thought I'll start a piece from this kind of messy almanac, which flips both ways and ends in the middle. And it's a kind of compilation of cheap dream notes from the Arctic and the Antarctic circles that I visited in 2017. And from these spaces kind of came out notes on fog and deception, on knowing, on truth, on what happens when the measurement fails. And when measurement fails, there's all these other ways of knowing and all these other ways of being that emerge. So maybe just to go right in, I'm going to start with one of the manifestos that came out of these journeys to the poles, and it's called Boatness. And Boatness, I felt at this moment when the ship's GPS had stopped working, there was a storm, and the captain realized that he needed to explain to us the parts of the ship in order for us to be able to operate the sails. And so he drew the ship in chalk on the deck and began to show these pieces. And I realized in that moment, there was that fleeting moment where the parts of the ship and the ship were a single one, where my knowledge of the world and my experience of the world had blended just for that split second. And I realized that intuition can be a method, because in that moment I felt the ship. The ship was me. Boatness. There is nothing to tell us that time has passed. The sky has not shifted, no shafts of sun, no heat, no dead darkness. We have become the sway of the boat, the whimsy of the wind in the sails, the squeak of the wood and the rope against the steel, the autopilot correcting the bunt, the binoculars, the charcoaled, smudged coastline. The captain is explaining the parts of the ship by drawing the ship on the deck in chalk. Meta is not even the word here. The boatness of the boat. We wait for Theseus. Is the drawing of the ship on the deck of the ship now part of the ship? The surface part of the sea, chalk part of chalk, part of the assembly of the ship, part of the time of the ship, 12 p.m. meaningless, 3 meals a day without a job or a city, a routine without a route, part of the analog mountain pixelated in the water, part of the premonition, part of the rhythm of the ship, she. The rhythm of the body, the adjustment of the body, the adjustment of the ship, histories erased by white, histories that never occurred, the failed experiments, evaporating permafrost, the closed mines, the fallen balloons, the runaway fox, the last shipment, the flooded seed bank, all conducted by clocks that do not know their part in it. The drawing of the ship on the deck of the ship is, therefore, an ocean in the ocean, the diagram of an eclipse, an S that needs only an apostrophe to plural, the myopic astronomer, all the while knowing that to draw a ship on the deck of the ship is to see the whole in a part, in the way that we can see the galaxy even as we are inside the galaxy. The boat is after the ark. It can tell big things from far away, as if it always saw love coming. The strong post of the eye, the fragile bend of the T. Love breaking. As if it knew it had made a promise it could not keep. Like inviting a rich guest for a dinner of bones. Like playing the triangle in an orchestra. Like sex after sex. Love like seaweed, unbodied and muscular. Seaweed like old cables uprooted by the elements, like antennas still sending tired messages at listless frequencies and amplitudes like anthills. Data suddenly poems. Then what? Electricity, light through the thickness of water gushing through the deck of the ship, the drawing erased. Only mast and moonraker left to steer the whole hull. This is maybe how love feels. Seaweed in the ocean, seething between shore and shallows, disembodied. Arms and legs and eyes everywhere, sinking and drifting. Sending missives to the gridded world, saying, where are the bounds of what you can only sense? Boatness is the thing that sustains till the new love comes. That ellipses between love and love over and over. The next piece is called Subcontinentment, and it's a kind of South Asian futurism manifesto. Drawing connections between South Asia and the Arctic and the Antarctic, and realizing very quickly that it fails at this, but that materiality is somehow entanglement, and these places are not heres and theres and thens and nows, but they are entangled in each other. So this is a sound piece made with a soundscape taken, recorded during lockdown in Delhi.
Subcontinentment. South Asian futurism does not fantasize about a future because it cannot isolate the future from the past. It fantasizes about a life in between. It wishes to grab language by its horns, grab the English language by its horns, and wring it off its yeses and noes and everythings and nothings and hang it out to dry in the equatorial sun in the middle of infinity. Its locus is entangled, material and spiritual, subliminal and subversive and submissive at once. Bipolar. South Asian futurism is a witness to the ash warmth of the morning when the newspapers have smacked the ironclad gates and a few are lost in trees or transit. South Asian futurism dismisses its title, denouncing South Asia as a universal region without specificity, denouncing futurism as an accomplice to the violence that comes with acceleration. South Asian futurism would like to call itself subcontinentment. A skewed portmanteau of subcontinent and contentment. An idealistic futurism that is scientific but does not believe in science as a solution. Its science fiction does not project a dystopia despite the carbon. It wants an alchemy of knowledges. It wants rumors, humors, hypotheses. It wants ancient imaginaries and everyday erasures. It wants to rest. Where happiness is fleeting, our contentment finds rest. Not rest like stillness, but the kind of rest in music. A held pause, an interval with the pedal down. Or rest like a lily pad, floating flat against water, an absolute zero coated in an armor of wax. repelling the too muchness of life. Lightness born by horizontality. We are the poetry of brown bodies. We take your criticality and raise you immediacy. Subcontinentment says it is a part of and apart from. Subcontinentment says we are one body that is tear gassed over and over again if we are not cautious. The specter of freedom in a world which cannot be reversed but reprinted in the form of 2,000 rupee notes. Purple hearts dreaming of life on Mars where money will be cosmic and Gandhi will look through lotus-colored glasses and see temples built on tombs. Palimpsests of pulverizing precarity. Praying to the gods of geometry, their indeterminate equations, to the deflection of light by the moon, to suspension, apparition, gravitation, levitation, indirect vision. Subcontinentment swerves through space. It aspires, transpires, desiring, first of all, an understanding of labor. Love lost to slavery. Subcontinentment is retrospective, but it is not repair. It does not revisit its indentured past, but it does not try to escape it, imitate it, sublimate it. Subcontinentment is an oath. We matter. It is a reinterpretation, a limited vocabulary with infinite combinations like a place without a perimeter. We are anti-directional, anti-event. Our days are counted, but our time will not run out. Subcontinentment is replenishment. Subcontinentment, like the age-old saying, remember the future. The chuckles that sentence gets every time, even in the mirror universe where time unfolds another way, countering memory or avant-garde delay. We are opposite like that. We are ours. We are kinetic. We are still. We are non-violent. We are complicit and cinematic. We are not a unified we, but inclined toward a collective body, autonomous and fugitive. Subcontinentment emphasizes interdependence over individualism, speculation over spectacle. We, the South Asian futurists, now the subcontinent mentalists, petition from the equator for new meridians. We wait for the collapse of capital from the nucleus of a bat's being. We are tarnished by the corrosion of materialism. We pass, forage, name again. We claim an ethics of belonging, an aesthetics of not. Subcontinentment is a reclamation. Enthusiasm reconfigured from sadness. The mobilization of joy. Subcontinentment is always already smiling. Subcontinentment believes that happiness is related to goodness, but neither is related to enhancement. It wants to clean garbage not by flinging it into space where golf balls and garters smash into the sun's stellar radiation and combust out of any evidence at all. Charged by crisis, it dances its discontent. Its revolt is not lethargic. It emerges hardened with dust. When it freezes, it releases heat. It is not fatigued by the alien antibodies that move through it. We, the subcontinent mentalists, align ourselves with the Afrofuturists, Sino-futurists, Ethno-futurists, Indigenous futurists. All the intergalactic dreaming, our retro foresight, the boomeranging to the moon, the salt desert like a blank slate of ice, the alienation of extraterrestriality. To be as it is. Subcontinentment is anti-extinction. It proposes radical survival, inhabiting the architecture of loopholes. Subcontinentment looks up toward the Arctic, where maybe the Vedas found home in the low sun and the early moon, and maybe not. Subcontinentment looks downward toward the Antarctic, with whom it shared edges and borders way back when in Pangaea. It finds common fossils, one of them an embossed ficus religiosa. It finds mica, which shimmers like something far and rare. Subcontinentment says, go there. Huddle close together, against the wind. Pleasure, even at the end. We are opposite like that.
I'll end with one last short piece called What? And I just decided on a whim right now to read this because it's past midnight here. So there's the delirium of illegibility, but also it's arriving back in India post this year of immense upheaval and finding that most of us have lost our voice here. There's a government kind of waiting to censor everything we say. So this poem is actually from 2012, I wanna say, but it feels like it's echoing right now. It's called What? We say, we write, and the words we say means no word for, and we have no word for, no words for what. Maybe the mysterious seemed to be what. Or standing silent in art as grand as 100 of what. This desire in the spiral is what? Loss erases presence, or there is no word what. Everything dissolves. I remembered how I felt presence like longing, full of so much what.
Wow, that was incredible. Hi, everybody. It's such a treat to get to read with Himali and Simone. Himali, whom I've just discovered, and Simone, who I adore. I wrote down some things just now, and I really love we are complicit and cinematic. I'm totally in a trance from that. So I'm just going to read a little bit. I chose something at random, then I thought I'll read something because Himali's reading made me think of it. So I'm going to read that for you. So it'll be like three little pigs. My reading will be. I'm just setting a timer so I don't screw that part up. And I'm not even going to bother trying to explain what this book attempts to do. I'll simply say that it tries to do more things than one book should do. And that's neither here nor there. But the section I'm going to read to you from is called The Saddest Year of My Life. And I will explain that section a little bit. So of the many things this book tries to do, this is one. I had an experience of PTSD that was triggered by an experience that was sort of trivial. So a semi-trivial encounter with a kind of relatively benign fool brought on a whole experience that was an experience of silence and a lot of bodily somatic stuff. And I tried to write poems for that. I became sort of addicted to silence at that time. And these are some poems that attempt to bear witness to that. Just a few, since this is the section I opened to at random. Is my timer going? Just making sure. I'll be the clown in the middle here, who's like, all my technology breaks and the clock breaks. Okay, good. We're good. We got this. Yes. Confessional poem. I expected the world would respond to my thought. I had seen some ads. I had been to their school. Forgive me. I didn't know where to turn. I didn't know where to look. Do not forgive me. For I did know, but I couldn't bear it. The saddest year of my life. I'm going to pause and say, so I mentioned that this book tries to do more things than a single book should. And because I opened at random to this section that's about me and my personal pain, I feel like it's necessary to also say that, like, part of what this book intentionally tries to do is to constructively trivialize, or contextualize in a constructively trivializing way the experience of me and my personal pain. The saddest year of my life. I was crouching over my phone, waiting for it to tell me what to do. In that breast-swelling town where a gray haze sprouts over the lips of the water, trailing a chemical film all over her, stepping, dripping from the shower, nobody asking after the green ivy hiding everything behind the alley. Yesterday, I stumbled over a barefoot, Nefertiti corners in the mouth of Joan Baez. Do you even remember going to bed with the wrong man? Sorrow slackening around him. I don't believe in the possibility of the wrong man, for I am the woman, the wrong one, watching the mute, mattifying gentleness of those spruces. He is waiting for the morning. He awaits his morning feeds. An indoor man. extrusions, my fits, sick of turning my senses away, something necrotic behind the skin of the lower thighs, blacking out the world, nostalgia, Portugal, cup with J t-shirt, football, and I would of the neoliberal art performance game in a Portuguese potato, and they will, and spherical like the earth, a certain slender Iberian sick muse or another forfeiture. Decline. I forsook my dreams, but they came back. They came back for me like a scum I could never despise enough. Missed appointments, theological thirst, a feeling of freedom experienced despite my presence, visible magnificence, very fast, floating in my belly. I perceived a burden, Peruvian, a beautiful poet, avenues, who did as I pleased, or my dreams. When I personally closed form, I can form, that clouds, to uncover the man ring. His little finger, thick like a horse's deep dimple, screwed me, virginating with my head, extracted yesterday's mange, took and gave mange under the sun, aura thickening. I crawled, you do. Inwardly, so much, but into weather remonstrances. It loved his glasses, curls, dinner and gin, charging derelict yard, white pommel, the same tongue, laboring. First the beards were there, then the berries were there, ankles and docks, a crust of glass, licking the glass, windows in piles, stacks of white casement. She threw back the sash, a synthetic plush. It could mark you. It's not a mulch. It is the red, afraid of being pushed across the border where Agrippa was waiting. He had become disorganized, scrolling boots by opening ceremony. And where was I? I was there, and I too had begun to cling to little pieces of trash. I feel like self-cruelty is really out of fashion, but it's something that for me is culturally very important. So I hope that it doesn't cause you too much pain. I really enjoy the severity that I can only really satisfy with literature. So, for Himali, let's see, did I lose it? Here we go. I'm not quite sure why this came to mind in your beautiful reading, but I offer it to you. Wellfleet. It is such a silence that its gloss would take forever. Like a face whose sun is a con. Like the veil warmed by this self-same con. Like seven veils, each on the seven gay pillars, rubbed down with creamsicles and attar of rose. Maybe I want to end it. What I mean is I want to see it raised. Like a Z hissing through white underpants, hot with spit, many Z's and vermeil Z's from cartoon sleeps when your body says drugs, when the sun drops its goo down your vents and the more you lick them, the more the speakers hiss, and that's like adulthood. When I pried open your ass, I smelled the fried chicken you'd eaten. Or when our fuck was like a Greek coin and I yearned to fall down and worship. Or how myrrh smells like shit exactly like sweet shit on fire. Is it active enough to be itself? He chortled, rubbed with herbs. The sky was vapid and seething all morning. I had no money. The entire quarter consumed in such silence, its steps and the stoops of its steps consumed in such glacial silence. I knew it was the sound of slowness to which the air itself was palpably, even as we walked through it, capitulating. Just a ripple shaking down its pole. When the belly really is the middle, it has its own navel, your belly softening under its navel, the sun whitening down from the stars that tickle a spider's legs into the anxiety which becomes her murder, her absolute form. I mean, this state, I was born in it. And having returned to it, can only think the only thing that makes any sense is to have come out of it never to return. Here is a ticket. It is an ancient ticket. It is about 50 years old. Do you think it's still good? It depends. When snow blankets the pass, our days spun to particles that shine even when we hate them, just like everyone else's. Like this extreme fineness did not just happen. It was made by an asshole who took. And it is like freedom. It is like freedom sometimes. It is so big. Too big not to be grand, but it is not grand, but it is so big. This embraced you from all sides like the gelid god it was, with its zapping clitoral elves by the 100, 10 hundred billion thousands in a hiss of clean soda water, accomplishing turnings, acclaimable feats, tricking on the dusky loom of Kabir, means wrought ends achieved in absolute butts and total finishes that bury your face in blooms, gushing dickhole tears that once you've dealt them, you've smelt them, and once you've done that, it's like you took their smell away. But you didn't mean to. You're a nice person. Like when it's too raw to be free, but that's freedom. When uvular clots spewing yogurt and minerals in a sea of boiled wool still has a winner, even though it sounds equal just because it sounds equal, it still has a winner, and its winner is me. I mean, like you're sucking the pit of the peach until your tongue is sore. You're sucking the pit of the peach until your tongue is sore, until your tongue is tonsured, until you've swallowed your tonsured tongue, swallowed Beowulf's, Maccabees, the trick that the moon is small. Like, why don't you get that it's only a trick that the moon is small? Actual men near like the moon. Are there any? The moon is hung at the end of a dark arm, over us a warm arm, our arm, and it from where we are is equal to the sun, and it does matter where we are, it matters where we are. It puts a cloud of ink in my jelly, in the dew gels now everywhere, cropping up on the shoals. It runs like razors along the sides of a school of fish, slicing your forelegs open in the sea, which is not a sea, but the ocean at its outermost, where the lords, which are only shoulders athwart heads all bemossed and in concert, turn toward the edge where the sun dips under, which under, when it's hard to swallow the seat of the first end to a day where the throat closes and gags on the sun. Mountains unbegrimed but submerged but still retaining their heads when the sun dips below the row at the outermost lip of the world. And when the copper-colored humped back part of the universe we can see from there, when the copper-colored humped back part of the universe we can see from there, obviously copulating with its other unseen regions that it obscures with its heaving. When the copper-colored humped back of the part of the universe we can see from there uncoils, like the thing that shot pain into your friend's head when he thought it was love he was making. And that was his load he was going to get to be blowing. When the copper-colored humped back of this side of the copulating universe uncoils and unbends and sighs its very long milk size of years by the 100,000 millions eddying into pools at the edge of the eye of the lucky one. When its ducts are sucked for the buds that hurt when they give. The sky, the blue line drawn at the top of the page by the four-year-old, the blue line drawn by the boy representing the sky, might be seen for once to be where it is, also under us. Okay. One more. And this is for Simone. Arena. I just have to take a moment and say it is so weird. This is so weird. Like, I'm just like at full delirium right now with Zoom readings. It's almost a year of this, like living this way. It is fucking weird. It feels weird right now. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for letting me say that. Arena. Because that light was not like the others, making us seem to be becoming a place. And because on a traffic island, the sun had filled me. And because my mother was crazy, and because she was sometimes sane, and because I was in love, and then I wasn't in love anymore. And because I was hungry, and because I needed to party, and because I was grieving, and because I had studied the Dust Bowl, the architecture at Delphi, Judaic and Islamic legends of Moses, Midianite theology, the history of Haiti, Aryan horsemen of ancient Iran, the collapse of Sumerian agriculture, Kundalini yoga, Alan Savory's and competing theories on desertification reversal, ancient and contemporary methods for ruminant grazing, grasslands and myths of grasslands, those Hopi stories that can be found in books, Roman haruspicy, Hellenistic astrology, the life of the Marquis de Sade, one or two novels, one or two volumes of poetry, Bulgarian choral singing, elements of contemporary sculpture, certain Gnostic scriptures, my own appetite. And because you can pay a professional to cleanse you of demons with a chicken egg. And because the air filled first with the odor of cheap men's cologne and then of human excrement over warming Pop-Tarts. And because one morning in Santa Monica, a woman emerging from a store was heard to say, "They don't have guns in the toy store." To which her man replied, "I know. He was seated beside a child. We'll get it in another toy store," said the man. And because an ugly incense was emanating from House of Intuition, and because Kabir wore a peacock feather in his cap and Krishna had one in his turban, and because King Solomon brought peacocks to Kiyim in a boat back from Tarshish, and because I fell down sobbing over a beaded cloth, and because what I had for so long failed to see, what I had ignored, mistaking it for ornament, was information hiding in plain sight, and because there was no way to touch what was converging on us, and because once there were oil pits near Arderica and a pitch spring on Zacynthus, and because Iris was the messenger of the gods I'd forgotten, and because the iridescence in the peacock was due to a complex photonic crystal, and because that crystal was silica, and so for the most part was sand, and likewise the stones to which desolate people increasingly communicated their wishes, and because glass was melted sand, and Johnny Cash was attacked by an ostrich, and because pens used to be made of feathers, and because Chopin and George Sand had been miserable on Mallorca, and because there were dust storms on Mars and sandstorms in China, and Israel was investing heavily in anti-desertification efforts, and because Papa Doc had shorn Haiti's mountains of trees, and when dust from Azerbaijan blew into Tbilisi, I lay with a nihilist in a fenced-in woods, and when strange lights appeared at the height of the spruces, there was dust on our tongues. And because I navigated by the pine cone in my skull, same as everybody else, and because a bird had alighted on the lectern of Bernie Sanders, and Mozart kept a sparrow as a pet, and because the mute son of Kenzaburo Oe learned speech from records of birdsong, and because of the bird friends of Odin and Massa, and because the gizzards of fowl were iridescent, and likewise the pearl, and likewise the viral unicorn frappuccino, and because Big Sur was on fire, and a hot wind was blowing over the Henry Miller Library, and because in Paradise, California, people burned in their cars, and because the bullets kept flying, and because the relentless spread of stupidity was allegorized in Flaubert's novels by grains of sand, and because idiocy came down onto Baudelaire on the wind of a wing, and because the less we could agree, the more it seemed we were evolving into a gem.
Thanks so much, Ariana. I'm thinking about glass, and I'm thinking Johnny Cash. I think that was really a pretty amazing poem, but also a great reading. Thanks. I like to dispense with the thanking of 20 people at the beginning of the reading, not because I don't love and appreciate you all, but because in the interest of time, we can have the conversation a little bit later. I see that I'm sort of frozen on the screen that I'm looking at. Is that a real technical problem or a fake one? Okay, I guess it's a fake one. So I'm gonna read from Or on Being the Other Woman. And I'm gonna try to pause as little as possible in this reading because I like to say that it's really just one poem. And sometimes there are poems that have little titles in between. One thing it's useful to know is that sometimes I'm talking about rap music I'm listening to, and usually I'll tell you when that is by saying a person's name or a song's name or something like that. And with that, I'm going to start all the recording devices that I need to start and set a timer and hopefully take 20 minutes or less. I have become misaligned or crooked with respect to the field of dependency, basically a free radical. If I keep looking at the word independent, I can see it surrounded by practices of sex work. It is always pussy that gives me value, and this fact of undeniable facticity must also enter my estimation of the state of my own excess. The forms my life takes have berserk intensity, dissolute facticity. Whatever means I use to accomplish liberation will lead inevitably to the destruction of someone's marriage. That's true. You rail against men, my lover writes to me. We use an encrypted form of digital messaging as if anyone cares what we say to one another. Certainly, I do not believe that anyone does, but these are his wishes. Men, as they exist in their bodies, are not the subject of my interest, so I do not rail against them. That is a misrepresentation of the whole of my aesthetic and phenomenological project, which involves taking up the vision I have been given of my own freedom. I have been given a vision of it, life beyond use. The white women who own the fancy nail salon I go to fired the manager I loved, a black woman photographer who treated me with professional respect. respect for my time, my lack of it. She knew my work and the work of my sister. She let me use my paid-for seat as a place to weep behind the screen of her conversation, using herself as a blessed covering for me, I realized. Those bitches don't want me in here. I understood I had witnessed an act of aggression against our presence, our desire to be adorned, to have comforts, to cultivate the rot of this corruptible, all its deathy glory. The nigger woman is the mistress of the world. Optimal dependency being a flowering of sexual and other forms of competition. Indeed, the field articulated as has been is a mode of transit to and fro in a determinate plane, a machine parallelism, slide even. A thought that allows for the permanent possibility of trajectory, when what arrests, contracts, seizes time in time, swallows, causes the secure ego to become anxious, the round back of pouncing animalia, my swooping compatriots, and all prey. Movement unsafe and disorganized in this beautiful quantum wilderness. These are the materials. At your best, you are love. I must next texture the generative energy of this poem by writing what I know about our love. To loop in genre identification and emotion can dictate what is next, what causes what. I call myself ethically to account for dependency. I brought this term to describe a quality of femininity from which I have broken, not by choice, yet broken absolutely anyway. To account for opacity I sense in the poem that is not from art or privacy. I want to be empathetic. The only rule I've had, I will not hide or lie. I closet myself in order to protect you. Is this true? And in this, have I done right? I do not know whether knowledge about sexually inflected dependency, the economic, emotional, and racial matrix that forms Black women as persons who carry, fuck, never tire, and remain impoverished, is related to knowledge about who this writing is for and what I am in offering the writing. What is the kind I imagine for myself, in bidding as I do, where monetary uncertainty is the same as begging? If I am writing a script, it is a script for performance of the intellectual status of the art professional. If it is an epistle, it travels no distance. Because of the way you are with me and yet are not of this world, we cannot now lop the letter off from the Messiah. As texture, writing is as we are. Investigation in a compositional attitude characterized by supplication or doubt. Selecting can be the only verb with adequate power. Technological operations are infused with each creature's adequacy to the vibrations. I love to think of riding and being ridden by constitutive quanta. I have experienced this with you, bodily, and also being admired on the street, as Black love is metaphorical. Therefore shocking. With you, I have been inventing a manner of experiencing the end of my life under this dispensation. I have not meant any of the meanings of every word they say. It is not clear you have not meant them, or understand how I hold off the figure of my sex in my mind to get between the figure and love. In my graduate seminar on the materiality of Black womanhood, we were in the room cowering at words we know for describing things. I think I felt fear in the room, but maybe I am odd and make others feel odd when they must yield the floor because I am the teacher to the hesitant language I drop into. I think the unfitness of words is the base from which we might understand such concepts as barbarity, the crudeness of words, their impingements, Such rough modifications as we make sweep violently through empty space. Can we see acts of caring for one's sane self, the skinless remainder that I must be, in intimacy with my loves, or attuned to the needs of my child, or truly to discern what is called thinking, as helplessness, where writing is as we are. My time is not the same as your time already. That time was not on me, symbolically or otherwise. It is only like clothes to me. It brushes on me more or less, and can keep the elements off my body if that is what I need in order to survive an interval. Figure one, that other time, as an ugly garment made of what would decompose but for innovation in methods of slaughter and preservation, on the workhouses, I am, you are, we are dependent. Each word a slaughterhouse, we go to be enclosed. I struggle with the idea of outside daily. My faith in the possibilities for existence outside my own formation, little more than a trickle most days. Even on occasions when I consent to being, for you, what I appear to be. I understand this as giving, but you do not understand it to be giving. Perhaps because it is not possible to give. More likely, because what I am supposed to be cannot give, choose, decide. In our love, a variety of embattlement that approximates my fundamental struggle to live and thus to change is an embodiment of the life struggle within or inside. With you, I see my life struggle eroticized. Outside, figure two, a darkness of true interminability until the end, until a thing comes into existence out of it. This struggle, being mathematically impossible with respect to dailiness, while mothering is a compound of dailiness and striving with the physical material with which I have to work. Our love as pain appears as a high form of aridity that presumes nothing. I think about Gail Jones. Once in a while, I read all the stories I can find about Gail Jones, her early books, her corregidora, her husband who cut his own throat with a knife in their house in Kentucky. Why was Gail Jones living in Kentucky? Wait, I always ask myself the same question and I don't look it up, and I'm not going to find out now either. In the night, while I'm lying awake for 2 or 3 hours, panicked about money or the loss of my lover, or worrying about congenital alcoholism, I see before me a grieving and blood-spattered Gail Jones led away by police in handcuffs to a psychiatric hospital. I want to talk about abandonment. I don't believe poetry or writing or love want death from me. Rather, my son began using this word rather in the last 2 weeks, so I'm sensitized to beauty and iterations of being instead. Rather, I am cheered by the absolute indifference of the universe to my desire. A long time ago, I gave over to godlessness. That is, there is no God, but there is something like division or departure or rapture that neither begins nor ends each time I am abandoned to an eruption of understanding. Months spent agonized and dumb end suddenly in a text message that includes the phrase, this weird distance between us, wherein I learn of the distance as such or have suddenly language for the helical structure of my own madness, which has danced comically in my body as passionate enjoyment of a form of intimacy I had not been taught to hope for. Our love, which is for the genius of one another, the mysterious arrangement of your power of sight and of listening, your blindness to the most basic rules, too, of matrimony and divorce, I love and laugh about. In my own being subject to those rules and knowing them by rote because I was trained in the law by the ruling class and because I have felt the power of the state come down on me, if only as infant incident to my father, the criminal, a man maximally disinterested in fairness. passion twinned with disdain for the not knowing of men, not how or know how patriarchal ignorance of how my child's clothes are bought. When I say, your white woman lives on my back, and this becomes true again and again. Again, the distance which routes your belonging in the public world as a man is the end of me, so that I cannot be at all within its embrace, in your arms, my love. For all these reasons, I did not want to be a poet. If I have anything like a materiality, see, I experience it in the discovery of how distance means between us and disturbs the thing I am with all things. My spirit, which I have abandoned to you, cannot writhe at the door of that other world. I am outside that world. I have tried to tell you in this poem. I have been put out of it and put myself out of it in love for you and with you. I think in units of $1,000. Each thousand allocated in a disorganized manner to the rubbish heap of my debts and obligations. This is a maintenance unit distinguishable from a unit of basic economic safety. However, I reject the notion that it is unrelated to survival. Derived from the extremity of my educational status, though not a direct result, mechanisms through which debt is incurred include education, but can also be related to depressed wages, wage differentials, wages and bureaucratic delay. 90 days is an eternity to wait for $1,000. A bad child support regime, a regime, the entire lack of a system of affordable child care or safe and effective public schooling for Black children. Bourgeois expectations regarding generational wealth is a secret killer. That and the fact that class war rages for decades beyond the first money. Norms of gendered responsibility and financial dependency through marriage are plainly dangerous. I wish people of all genders would stop talking to me about their fucking spouses. I must start asking, how much money do they make? Don't this nigger see me working? I think $1,000. I would not trade my law degree for anything, though. Harvard Law School taught me to look at the ruling class, look at my marginality to it. I dealt myself into an art world where there was no bohemia, excepting its secret ruling class remnant. Economic violence is a term from which I feel dissociated. I dissociate myself from its use. Being so far from poor, only desperate, I cannot see how violence encompasses my calculations or the irregularity of $1,000 transactions. 2 times 1,000 is debt service of 2 distinct types, 1/3 my take-home pay. Each time I make $1,000, it's time to pay back tuition. If I gig hard enough, I'll catch up this year. Income appears to me in fast-moving sheets of $1,000. Given my deficit and the way I bust ass, I can spend $11,000 in a month on the ledger. My mind is never blank. It is on the next check. Don't these niggers see me working? LOL, the irregularity of my thought, my vulgar $1,000 functions. I'm going to read one more. I should say there are 2 poems in this manuscript that were written kind of as a collaborative project with the poet Ben Krusling, whose poem I don't have and therefore can't read. But I'm just going to read one of these poems, which is called Go to Jail. And I took the title from Ben's interest in this Chief Keef song, Go to Jail. There's 2 like little bits from Du Bois's Philadelphia Negro at the beginning. When he dies, he cannot be buried beside white corpses. His neighbors have barricaded their porches against his view. Go to jail. Months later, only able later, for many months holding the image of myself in the kitchen, an image of raising up out of the nothing feeling, which isn't not feeling at all. I don't feel nothing. I feel like I want to strangle somebody most of the time. Seeing the image as an energetic problem of not being raised up to, junky and at the ready, I'm saying, up and above the vagueness of knowing togetherness. There we were together learning. The spiritual and the literary should never be confused. I am not in my body. Acts of holding, not exactly trying to resolve how it is I am involved in Chicago's war, though I'm interested in anticipating a certain kind of moral demand. Pussy, how you warring is meaningful to me in its digital strike or pluck that covers the time within which it becomes instantly possible to gather as the high frequency is withheld. The passion is in the stinginess of the strike, the tease. There are two definitional proposals with respect to the hi-hat in that song, I'd say. One allowing it to become drill. This is refrain or pattern. The other proposing singularity or arrest. Something incredibly stupid or bad in that plinky anti-loop. It curls up around the spasmodic coughing from which it is technically and sonically a part. And the completely undanceable horror of this Ike pack. No one stops dancing. I am holding close to me Maymay's voice with me at all times when I am thinking different problems with working or beginning with the non-relation between me and them. Always making an excuse for feeling close, scuttling away. Dancing is not an endorsement of violence, but of course it is. When dancing, holding also the problematics of uplift, I do feel spread out. I feel helpless and resent the sense that separating myself from feelings of love and enjoyment for the sake of so-called liberation is fucking us all up. Do I know myself to be a person who is stalked? Am I a killer? I can barely stand the convergence between Maymay's star book and what I am trying to say about feeling empathy. You try to hold on to the visibility of its object and its location. Just as unbearable when the object is a form of personal power. Now I'm close. You're laughing at my orgasm joke, but it's not a joke. I ain't joking. From which I have learned to be irresolute.
Hi, welcome back, everyone. I feel that we have landed at a meeting place, at a sort of mouthful experience of language, of berserk intensities, and we've arrived here in full delirium, going back to Ariana. So I'd like to start by discussing the role of love and intimacy appearing in all of your readings in different ways, as heartbreak, irresolvable conflict of heteronormativity and monogamy, in the erotics of femininity, in the copulating universe, in the complicity, in the closeness, in the relational nature of a we beyond national and social formations, but also in, you know, the metaphorical of Black love, abandonment, the soreness of the tongue, a nail saloon where to weep, in the brokenness and fragility of oneself, how to trivialize that pain. So I want to ask about those intensities and frequencies, and how love and intimacy have informed your practices. Who would like to go first? Maybe Himali.
For me, love functions in both a literary tool, as well as an actual real feeling that holds disparate elements together. As a literary tool, I love this Calvino story that he tells in I think it's in On Quickness in Six Memos for the Next Millennium, where the Emperor Charlemagne has this enchanted ring, and whoever has this ring falls in love with the person who has the ring is the object of love. And finally, the ring is thrown into this lake, and the emperor looks out at the lake for the rest of his life and is in love with the lake. But what it does is that these multiple stories, the ring goes from a girl to this emperor to finally the lake. All these stories are held together by this ring of love, this like object of attraction. So I love that idea that actually love can be this force of attraction holding, like the list that Ariana made in the last poem was so amazing, and it felt like it was held together by love. And then as a real feeling, it feels like it can hold, it can form a kind of continuity between the human world and the non-human world. So we may be talking about the object of our love, but we are also talking about all of those energies in between, and the kind of ability to abstract ourselves in order to love the other, which is not loving the self, but is also loving the self. That's all for now.
I guess what I would add is that I think that I am not thinking about love as a metaphor, as like a device of any kind. Like I am thinking of it as an experience of like deromanticization or something like that, coming to understand how relationality and relationships as a process of like as a life process or a process of maturing or dying the idea of love has to be, and the experience of it has to be kind of reconciled with the truth of it, which is that it is not a romantic experience. It's an experience of like complete somatic disorder that, you know, for me anyway, that doesn't actually have much to do with social structures, and is often like an enormous interruption to them. And so at least that's been my experience, and you know, that's partially like a racialized experience and an experience of having primarily like had romantic and sexual relationships with men. But I think but definitely like love is a heuristic, I would say that, like in my work, you know. I want to think about it as something that is like very, very, very real, if that's a thing.
I guess what I could add to this seven-layer dip lasagna of love is maybe like on this like basic level the polarity of having a lyric speaker having a vow, that's like a nice polarity for poetry. It kind of sets up a certain clarity. It gives you an addressee in some sense, and that's attractive. It's always been attractive for me, but I feel like I haven't been in love for several years, and I was thinking about it this morning in the shower, like, because I've had like many loves or whatever, but I don't think that I know anymore what I thought in love was before. And there was a time that I felt that I had achieved some kind of universal love because I felt like there was more love in my writing and in my relationships than I remembered when I was kind of in these solipsistic experiences of in-loveness, that I thought that's what that was. And I thought, I've achieved universal love. This was like a few years ago that I like pompously was thinking that. And then it occurred to me that when I'm inside the experience of poetry, like when I'm inside reading poems or when I'm hearing poetry, like listening to Simone and Himali read today, I'm overwhelmed by how much love poetry is made of. I can't even, it vibrates with it. And that's totally different from the kind of relational and the daily, or maybe not, I don't even know, it's a mystery. But it almost shocks me. Like it's filled with it. If the whole thing is the substance of it, I feel, or I felt in my delirium today.
Yeah, there's some, I suppose there's also this idea of love that can manifest as a sort of communistic affect that extends beyond the reach of our linear timelines and was felt through today. This idea of deromanticizing that Simone was talking about that goes with deontologizing experiences. And perhaps thinking of this latter one, I want to talk about relationality and I want to talk more precisely about relationality through sound, through phonic substance, through these berserk intensities that you've all alluded to, and how your poetry contributes to an ethics of listening. I truly think they do. So Simone, yesterday in the workshop, you told us that you've listened to rap all of your life, more recently trap. And or in the last few years, in that in listening, you also began thinking about how you occupy space with others, with people, with objects, with history. So I'd love to hear a little bit about that. And also from Himali, you've offered us subcontinentment, which is a sound work that you do in collaboration with David Sonck-Topser. And of course, there's the intensity and vibrations that go through the sort of polar, the research in polar circles, and the sort of imagining or reimagining of futurist manifestos, how that plays out through those historical ruptures that may be easier heard than seen. And then again, Ariana, with the attraction and addiction to silence, with listening to birdsong. So I'm thinking around this idea of or this question of attunement and how sound, which is something that we've been exploring with Sonic Continuum, one of our research trends here at Nottingham Contemporary, and how attunement specifically can help us see these threads of connection that generate instead of occupying relations. So perhaps Simone, would you like to go first?
Try. I guess I love that you have a group that's studying listening. That makes me very happy, and because it took a long time for me to understand my, I'm like a music nerd, just an ordinary like music nerd who likes to listen to all kinds of music and has always been a little bit interested in, organizing other people's listening experiences. But it wasn't until I had my son in 2014 that I started to have what felt like a different kind of bodily experience around listening, which seemed more like a kind of vulnerability or like deep affectability with respect to sound that I hadn't really thought about before. And I think, you know, partially had to do with the fact that my body was in some distress after the birth of a child, and I was feeling vulnerable both physically and emotionally. And but also that the particular sounds that I was attracted to were sounds that seemed to speak to the emotional terrain of like openness, or you know, extreme openness, and not being able to organize one's responses, but being penetrated by sound, by being enveloped by sound. Some of the things we were talking about in the workshop yesterday, where one is not in control of the vibrations, but the vibrations are, you are part of the vibrations and inseparable from them. And so it really, you know, that really was transformative for me. And also, you know, being in conversation with Jace Clayton over the last many years about what, you know, how to write about sound, and also how sound can be made part of one's practice, one's writing practice or otherwise, has been really helpful to me, just sort of because, you know, I was first trained as a lawyer and then, you know, like uncomfortably fit into a literary critical framework as a professional training. But I was never able to, I could never really formally accept any of the sort of traditional tenets of either of those practices. I'm not a literary critic, I'm a poet. And so I have always needed to find ways to, you know, not to represent, to show or demonstrate the ways in which I'm being affected by things. And I, you know, this last half a decade or so has been about being affected by this mild change in the vibrational frequency that Black people have been putting out in this music, you know, and like trying to understand what that change is.
Yeah. Hey, Molly.
I love that last thing you just said, Simone. And in a way, something similar happened, particularly with the sound of the ghazal that you hear, and then the kawal, which is the Hindu and Muslim prayer in subcontinent, is that the months preceding the lockdown, we had protests because the government tried to create something like the anti-Muslim ban in America. And so we were on the streets every day, and it was like a festival. In a way, it was a collapse of time and space for these many different kinds of people, classes, castes, in a way that doesn't happen often. So when lockdown occurred and you could suddenly hear the rising, the five prayers from the mosque, and then the temple prayers, and then the screeching seagulls from Antarctica to the crows, who we really hadn't heard these birds since the 90s here in the face of untrammeled modernity. So what happened is that the sound of this silence began to speak itself back to us. In the wake of the government's closing and erasing the graffiti and the protests, we still had those sounds allowing us to believe that we were a certain kind of body of people. And then just to connect to the first question is that David made the sound for this, but he's also my partner. And so I live with someone that I love that is constantly using rhythm to manipulate time and to understand space in ways that we can also then access different forms of justice through. So we are always thinking about this, and this becomes a kind of rhythm that is just underlying with the coffee that you make or the yoga that you do. It's there in everything. It's the punctuation for us, I suppose.
And the power of being able to syncopate those sociopolitical chronologies and still have that relational language that is rhythm connecting us all and connecting struggles that may be quite different in experience, in extent. So this is, yeah, this is really beautiful as you articulated it. Ariana, is there anything?
Yeah, so there's three little simple things that I thought of that might be too simple, but maybe they'll fit. Poets are so wonderful as listeners. Like, you know, when I wrote a play, the whole play was meant as a sound piece. And if I could have had the whole thing happen in darkness, I would have, but, it was great to hear Simone and Hamali. Like, so three really trivial things. That's my word of the day. One, so these are three things from lockdown. One, I remember that the only crowd sound of the last year that I have experienced is the sound of protest. That's the only crowd sound. And as somebody who lived in New York for almost 20 years, that's the only crowd sound other than birds was being in demonstrations, number one. Number two, two like triggery sounds from the New York City subway that came back to me. It was like 3 months in to the pandemic and I wasn't living in New York. And I just suddenly had this like intense sense memory of the subway. And I grew up playing music and I don't know if I'm oversensitive or if I'm just crazy, but like there's two sounds that you'll hear in the New York City subway that are just so like they always like drive me crazy. One is men clipping their nails, which is so New York. It's the only subway system I've ever been to anywhere where people clip their nails on the subway, and it's that sound. You know it if you've heard it. That's one. And the other, that, and this, it used to freak me out and then I gradually got used to it, but the sound of people killing things or like exploding things on their phone, just like playing those gun games on their phone and super loud, just like shooting things. It just always, I am gonna say another T word today, a word I never use. It triggers me to hear that shooting, the like iPhone shooting. And it was crazy to like suddenly remember what it felt like to hear those sounds, because I used to hear them every day. And they're still in my body.
I love this idea that poets are listeners. And I think that one of the beautiful things that we've come to discover through this multi-year, multi-platform research program is really, you know, how can we articulate through noise, through grief, through a number of seemingly unsounding or seemingly muted forms of protest. How can we articulate a practice of refusal, but also a practice of repair and of care? And with this, I think I would like to speak a little bit about healing and spirituality in your practices. It didn't sort of come across directly in the poetry, but there's obviously a very sort of alchemical, perhaps medicinal vision of art and poetry in this age of rampant violence against Black and brown bodies that and climate disarray that appear in Himali's writing, even in the form of the book, an almanac, But also, of course, it permeates your writing, Ariana, with Hellenistic astrology, with the founding gesture of the Invisible College. And I suppose in Simone's also ecstatic experience of being part of this gathering work that is music, and in this, you know, in resonating with and through trap. So the sort of, I wanted to learn a little bit about how your writing engages with rituals, with spirituality, and maybe myth and magic. Does that make sense?
A good question.
Mm-hmm.
Who wants to go first? You want to go first, Ariana?
No, you got to go.
I just, you know, like, in a way, I know this is going to sound like kind of silly or something, but the reason that I like find myself where I am now as a so-called intellectual or whatever is that I've always been, Black people are organized my like way of thinking about the world, how Black people operate in the world. And one of the things one of the sort of motivating activities of all my thinking is like, I remember reading Saidiya Hartman's Scenes of Subjection when I was very young. Maybe I was in law school, maybe it was right after law school. I can't remember, but I was very young, in my early 20s. And I remember thinking, like, I really cannot accept this vision of the world. Like, I cannot accept this. And it's not that I thought it was false. I thought that it was spiritually unbearable to imagine a condition in which Black people were saddled with pain for all of eternity. And you know, it has kind of motivated all my work, both as a critic and as a poet, to kind of find avenues for reorganizing our thinking and experience so that people can be released from that kind of despair and pain. Me included. I don't experience Blackness as a burden, by the way. I just don't. I experience it as, you know, a life-giving location, but not as a burden. And so, thinking about what poetics is, you know, whether poetics is the poetics of Joan Retallack or the poetics of Denise Ferrer de Silva, for me means giving some weight or meat to a description of what it means to be engaged in that kind of ritualistic reorganization. And I guess that is the kind of healing work. It's definitely spiritual work. That's it.
That's brilliant. Ariana, what do you have in mind?
That was so beautiful. I first want to say I don't have rituals. Everyone always wants me to have rituals. I don't light a candle or like say a prayer like that. It's not like that for me. I think that like only misery and desperation would force somebody so deeply into literature. You know, like you have to be pushed into searches of a spiritual nature and of a deep literary nature. Like I had to be pushed hard into it. And I think that like, in some ways I think of my work as a testimony or a testament to that search, but also it's a space where I felt like there were certain spirits, certain family spirits that needed to be borne witness to. And I felt their pressure very heavy and very hard on me. And now that I'm old, I'm a little bit satisfied at having done for these spirits really hard work, of having given them a place that isn't a place, but it's a place somehow. And that whole process of even being able to figure out how to do that is so alchemical, it's so transforming, that it's very mysterious, actually. And part of what I do in my writing is I've tried to make a record of certain experiences that I wasn't authorized to have, and that my mind wasn't conditioned to receive, and that I nevertheless did receive. But in a way, the most freaky thing of all is the changing art of writing itself. It's very changing. It changes the substance of your life in these ways that are really hard to fathom. And so somehow, like, if I'm a zealot of something, it's like the thing that I complain about the most, which would be writing.
There's the train. I love the choo-choo train just behind you. Kameelah, this is a good wake-up call. How are you feeling? How's your energy?
I'm okay. It's a rich question. And I feel like both poets have just said such beautiful things, and I feel like I fall right in the middle of all of that with how I feel about it. I mean, also, I guess being in a context where, you know, healing, or like there's so many traditions from Ayurveda to Tibetan medicine here, but they are always co-opted by someone or something or someone else. So that creates that immediate weariness around it. And then it becomes really important to see how can we make modern rituals? And how do those modern rituals allow us to not be nostalgic, but find a way of reconnecting with those ancestors or with that land, even while it is in a state of loss, but in a way that does not steal from some other community or someone that's using this not only as pleasure, but also as necessity. And magic, for me, would be operative also at a literary level. Like, language can do things. And as opposed to all of the old white men that have come before me that say that words are ineffable and ultimately there's no meaning, I'll insist that there's some magic between love, language, and time travel, that language can do things. And so maybe there's some ritualistic healing properties just in the very material that we're using. And we don't need candles after all.
And so as we're coming towards the final 10 minutes of our talk, I would like to invite everyone who's watching, if you would like to ask a question or share a thought, please do. In the meantime, I'm going to segue on this time travel and ask about history and temporality, which I guess temporality is almost a mantra in my notes from this evening. And I'm wondering how how do we develop relational practices that unlearn and make present pasts invented? What does he mean to enact that in the practice of writing and in pedagogy, which is also an important part of your practices?
I'll jump on that one. As I love the temporality in both of your readings, I feel like one of the things about the kind of digital, the social mediation, the technology that we're all, we've all been like scheduled by or clocked by in the last decade or so. One of the things about these technologies is that they're all about right now. And so there's a totally bizarre effect that the kind of necro techno fellow patriarchal hellscape, whatever, it does a really, really interestingly weird warping thing to our experience of the present and of time itself. And I feel like as a woman, time is always the neglected medium. That's the medium of the landlord. Like that's the real assholes. You know, that's the way you really, if you want to fuck people, fuck their time. And it's so interesting the way that we've been twisted and contorted into a kind of a now that's a kind of a parody of the now, or that we perform when we post or whatever. And so for me, it becomes like the most interesting space to work with. And when it comes to pedagogy, when it comes to what is teaching, you're being present with a text, if you're teaching a text, and present with the ones you're doing study with. And that's very, very interesting. It's very exciting because there's a kind of electricity that happens in that through that intimacy that can be very powerful. And we all know when we've experienced study in common around a topic or around a text where it's electrically present, those experiences mark us. You know, I remember like this Louise Labbé sonnet, you know, that I read in 1999 because we read it electrically in community. And so that's a beautiful thing. I'm done.
Iman, would you like to add?
Well, you may have touched on like one of my poetic weaknesses, which is that sometimes words stop making sense to me, and temporality is one of the words that has stopped making sense to me lately. I'm no longer sure what it means. And you know, it's partly, as you know, since we did this workshop yesterday, I'm really struggling with questions of like how you know, people's move through time and space. And I'm not sure I know what it means anymore, and or what people are referring to. And in some ways I can only understand it temporality, that is like the condition of being in time, as like whether or not I am waiting for something to occur. Do you know what I mean? Like, am I experiencing lag or a demand, an immediate demand? And so, you know, in some ways, like those things are much more pressing right now. Whether, you know, patience, questions of patience and waiting, which is something that is like, I mean, it's funny because Du Bois also talks about waiting. I love Du Bois. And, you know, like he says in Black Reconstruction, you know, that like basically all Black people did was wait. That's like how they saved themselves. And I think that's a pretty amazing formulation. And yeah, it's so, I don't have a therapist. I kind of wish I did, because I would love to be in conversation with somebody about the pressures of waiting and being patient and expectation and all that. That's what I'm kind of interested in time-wise these days.
And it's interesting as well that in that slowness, how it contrasts with the quickness that Himawi mentioned with of today and of Calvino's short story. Imali, I wonder if you want to contribute some thoughts on time travel. And
I was just gonna say that Bart in A Lover's Discourse said, "It is the lover who waits." Mm-hmm. I think it's true that those temporalities that we played in and wiggled in and loved so much in school and in college, it was like such ripe material to think about the past and the present and the future and the multiverse and like, and how you could travel between these places. It's become so complicated now when you think about certain bodies that can accelerate in time, certain bodies that are in time lags, and other bodies that have been completely stopped, especially during this year that is characterized by a pause in itself. So what is a stop in a pause? I suppose it's a semicolon, but then what happens? Can you have two semicolons in a sentence? And it feels, I share your confusion and distrust of time now, because it feels like it's wielding these powers over us. We also, when we think about time in the context of land, somebody just named the difference between an accident and a catastrophe. An accident being something that happens momentarily in the present, and a catastrophe that comes hurling from some past, but actually affects both the geological history and the future of the earth. So a meteorite will hurl from far outer space from the past, and it'll plop with the most anodyne kind of sentimentality. And then it will proceed to affect the entire geological future of the earth. Of course, no one's looking at the meteorite because it's a small, black, irregular object that makes no difference. And in somewhere around like the early 20th century, it was mostly women that decided this is actually worth our time. These rocks maybe can help us understand something, not only about time, but also about the place that we're on, and whose rocks are they? That was me rambling at 2 a.m. in India.
So late.
Well, thinking of time, I like to think that these material, despite digital, and sensuous spaces of gathering that public programs allow, these spaces of encounter, work towards a kind of temporal deprogramming, what Kojueshan calls the poetics of temporal deprogramming. And it's thinking about that distribution of future, thinking about that, you know, who has access to certain pasts, to operating in the present, who's lagging, who's progressing and moving forwards. So I guess I want to, with this, to say thank you, and also to take the opportunity to ask just finally, if you have questions that you might want to ask to one another. Any burning questions that need to?
I just loved both your readings so much, and I need to know the names of the poems again.
This is from a book that's coming called Or on Being the Other Woman, which, and the individual poems sometimes have names, but mostly not. I have a question for you, Himali. What is the circle behind you?
It's an enso, you know, speaking of the ring, it's the ring that is enclosed. So it has a space for potentiality. But my partner David is 7 feet tall. So he just did it in one big sweep, and it's hung horizontally. So it was, a single rotation.
The question I really didn't know that I had was, how tall is your partner?
I want to know about the Arctic. Can you explain more about the boat and the Arctic?
Mm-hmm. Actually, the boat was called Lady Antigua, she was a slave in the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. And she was on the bow of the boat, and I swear, mm-hmm. apart from me, she was the only body of color in the whiteness of the Arctic. But that's not true, actually, because I expected the Arctic and the Antarctic to be these lands of white, but you very quickly see the mud, you see where the glaciers have receded, you see the coal mines. So that this landscape is much more myriad than we think, and it's not this kind of other imagination of the alien body. It's us, and it's many voices, including the ice, but not limited to the ice, that are melting fast and don't have that language anymore. But yeah, I went on an artist residency in 2017, which was kind of amazing. And then I also went on a residency the same year to the Antarctic. So it felt like going to outer space. Yeah.
And perhaps, as you know, taking the motif of being ejected into those extraplanetary forces. If it sounds all right with you, maybe we can end the evening here, continue the conversation outwards from Nottingham online. And with this, I want to thank the three of you, Ariana, Imali, Simone, for the beautiful readings, for this moment of complete electricity that we had together. And to thank our viewers for staying with us. We will be back again with Five Bodies in a month's time. And we look forward to sharing that with you. Thank you.